the students of Humanities Department of this very iconic NIMS University. The campus looked so grand and so marvelous. It's just giving picture and sound of a very gigantic educational campus. Ma'am Deepika ji and all present faculties of your department and all students sitting here in this lab seminar room. Since just I came to know this is your workshop on computerization and it's just a intermediate program of this public-private partnership. As ma'am told me, told about me that I am a journalist, I am an author, and my academic background is economics. So I generally deals with public policy, and you know, you all students may be knowing, our economy is a mixed economy. Here government has role as well as private sector has also role. And since 1947, we were following the path of mixed economy. But in year 1991, there was a paradigm shift in our policy, and we initiated a new economic policy. The new economic policy was a series of reforms brought on time to time in a very round one, round two manner, in a reform one, reform two. And the reform which started in 1991, that is still continuing. And we also saw the party, the government, which initiated this policy, later on they become some kind of negligent and negative towards their own policy. And the other party which came in the power, they rather run very fast on this track of new economic policy. So I will not go into the big details of this policy. Only would like to focus, there were four main pillars: the privatization, the corporatization, marketization, and the globalization. So since 1991, we started to attract more and more investment, whether investment coming from the domestic player, whether coming from the foreign player, institutional player or non-institutional player. And nivesh, yani ki investment, was given top priority. And there were no any kind of bar, restriction. We just liberalized our policy in terms of inviting investment up to the 25%, 49%, 75%, 100% automotive route. And sector-wise sector, we just opened up our economy. And India just came on the very high growth path. And since then, we have a regular, at least minimum 5% growth in our economy. So one of the main features of our this policy regime was the injecting competition and just trying to create competition between public player and the private player, between public sector and private sector. And accordingly, the policies and program and plans were drafted. And we saw that there was an information, communication and telecom revolution taking place, which started since 1990 and that is still continuing. We brought around 3, 4, 5 telecom policy. We have a mobile revolution because there was one regulatory authority called TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. And they allowed public player and private player. We already have a public sector company like MTNL and BSNL and Department of Telecom. But when private player started to come and they just made their investment in creating infrastructure, in laying down of cables and all kind of station and tower and all that, and companies came under the telecom policy, and we saw the regime of Airtel, Vodafone, Idea, later on Reliance Infocom, and now a Jio, and so many regional and small level or big level company came in this. And the competition was very tough. And consumer found them the most cheapest telecom market in the world because it attributed because of competition between public player and private player. And all public sector company, they found themselves not competent enough to counter with, to cope up with private player, because there was no better work culture there. There was no cost consciousness there. There was no full utilization, maximum utilization of the available resources. And what we found, when competition started to take place, we have a more better scenario in terms of everything. Rather, the government gained more revenue. There was more employment. There was a more investment. There was more much cheaper market of telecom. So this was a very great model. That is why this topic, public and private partnership, has been chosen. That there were so many areas in our Indian economy which requires this sort of public-private partnership and also mutual competition between them. Not only the partnership, but also compete with each other. But for that we need one regulatory authority, and we all may be knowing the name of TRAI. And later on, we also instituted regulatory authority in sector like electricity. Because you may be knowing Central Electricity Regulatory Authority, that is called CERA. And all state governments, since electricity is a state subject unlike telecom, so all state government instituted their state electricity regulatory authority. But the model was not like telecom, so we didn't get a very fine and fantastic result from this electricity regulatory authority. Now we are talking about so many areas where this public and private partnership is required. There are many areas where there is a huge presence of private sector, and you are also one of the big example of that. In education sector in India, there is a huge presence of private player in technical education, in professional education, in formal education. You go to even primary level, even in rural areas, 40% schools are run by primary schools are run by private player, even in rural area. And the parents of poor children, they are also even not ready to send their children to government schools and getting their midday meal, because they think the teachers are not hitting properly on the students. The students are not getting proper knowledge. They don't have English medium education there, because all know what is the power of English medium education. And that has been the legacy of British period, that we created two kind of world. One is the English medium educated students, and other the vernacular medium educated students, and we created two kind of world in our Indian society. But the new education policy is strictly telling about use of all Indian languages as the medium of your education. And that was a fantastic initiative taken by our policy makers through this new education policy. So, I am talking about a public-private partnership. The same case applies in the education sector also, because private presence is already there, but there is no any policy regarding education. Our even new education policy don't talk about the presence of private player and their role and the goal, and also what is their prospects. They don't talk about it. They are talking about syllabus, they are talking about the curriculum, they are talking about newer sort of educational item, they are talking about physical education, NCC, defense education, moral education, sports, yoga, Indian culture, moral education, etc., etc. But first of all, we need to look after what is the status of education. And second, what is the status of health sector also. And it's a very coincident, your premise is just mixture of both human development sector, education and health. So I am talking about public-private partnership, and there is a huge presence of private player in education as well as in health sector. And I am talking about all over the country, because health has a three tier diseases also. The day-to-day diseases, medium sort of diseases, and very serious kind of diseases. And the government policy which has come in terms of Ayushman Bharat Yojana, that is catering to type 3 diseases. They are providing insurance to the patients. But they don't have policy for the type 1 and type 2 diseases. Private players are operating on. They are also facing competition. Sometimes they charge very high. Sometimes they also come under competition. Because you may be knowing, there is one scheme of Government of India that is called CGHS scheme, Central Government Health Scheme. And under that scheme, some government servant and the big MPs, MLAs, ministers, they get the facility of CGHS scheme. Since I am a journalist and I am also accredited journalist, as madam told you, so I am also getting that benefit. What I want to share my experience with you, that under that CGHS scheme, most of the private hospitals, maybe NIMS also, they are offering a very cheaper rate of consultancy fee, radiology fee, rooms rent, and all sorts of items of your health needs. And but that facility under the cheaper rate or the stipulated rate, only CGHS card holder can get the facility. But why not you are offering this facility for whole country, for the whole all citizens of the country? What is wrong in that? Your business will amplify, your business will expand, and you will have a surplus. No doubt about that. Because there is one theory after new economic policy, you took the a smaller margin and increase the volume of your business. That will be much better policy. So I am talking about public-private partnership. The same way the telecom market was expanded and all private players were happy to invest $1 billion and $1 trillion investment, because they are seeing the potential of this business. Because in the future everybody needs a smart mobile and all kinds of internet needs and all kinds of value-added telecom needs. And the companies are very happy to invest because they see the potential and the future prospects of the market in this sector. So the public-private partnership and the institution of regulatory authority is a win-win situation for all the stakeholders. And it is a win-win situation for economy, for government, for the consumer, for the public and for the private investor, and even in the investor from the government sector. You talk about sector, you talk about 250 public sector undertakings running under Government of India. Even many state governments are also operating many PSUs. They have a very robust kind of corporate culture. They don't face any red tapping kind of culture which is operating in government. The delayed decisions, the cost and the cost of project and time overrun, that is a very perennial problem in government. Most of the time, the time lag of projects are being increased, the investment limit is getting increased, and it creates losses to the exchequer, and also giving trouble to the people and the user persons. So when we apply public and private partnership, there will be a win-win situation for all, as I told you. Talking about education, since education is a vast sector and predominantly is a state subject, but you talk about a primary education, it is being controlled and run by local self-government. Nagar Palikas and Gram Panchayats are operating all primary schools under the supervision of district administration. It means the third tier is also operating. And talking about the second tier state, they are the owner of the all educational policy, educational institution. You talk about primary, secondary, higher education, university education, professional education, technical education, state government have all apparatus. And central government is just facilitating in a parallel manner in terms of their own CBSC, their own NCERT. They have a regulator like AICTE, which gives certification or license to all technical institutions running under the private sector or even under the public sector. They have all sorts of regulating agency like UGC, University Grant Commission. Just now I came to know about NUSA, Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan. So these are the authority and institution of Central Government of India, which you can say they are regulator, they are facilitator, they are certification agencies. So we can need, we have a need of one sort of education throughout the country. Might have a regional admixture of regional culture, regional needs, regional languages. But there must be one system and setup for the whole India if we want to create a really an egalitarian society. So we must have a one syllabus, one board, having all state, having branches, and the option must be given. What option you want to take, so that we have a equal kind of, it's a very uniform kind of personality making, human resource making, and the human development focus must have a no any kind of differential or any kind of unequal sort of treatment which we are seeing in our country. If somebody goes to abroad, somebody goes to Delhi and big city like Jaipur and Ahmedabad, and most of the people are just locating in their district town or in their kasba or in their village. So we must need, there is a one race going on among all educational institutions, that is called NACO. And under that competition, every institution is trying hard to make them a very corporate brand kind of institution. So we must have a equal treatment for all, and the same case applies in the health sector also. Now, talking about a public-private partnership, I would like to mention sector like railway. You all may be knowing that railway has a huge infrastructure pushed up in last 8 to 10 years, and 2,50,000 crore has been invested in the infrastructure sector of infrastructure making of Indian railway. And railway has a very high class railway station, tracks are being doubled, and broad gauge, narrow gauge are being converted into broad gauge, all lines are being electrified, and so many things are being taken in terms of checking all sorts of possible accidents, and technical upgradation are going on. So I am talking about why don't you invite in private sector in the railway. Because railway, private sector has been injected in railway in terms of so many things. The railway cleanliness work has been totally awarded and contracted to private player. No government player is have any interference in the cleaning of Indian Railway and all their setups. And same way, there are many trains which have been delegated to private player. They are managing everything. They are taking the notice of housekeeping, operating, all kinds of fare they are taking, they are deciding the fare and all. I think this is not the good way. You must have a regulatory authority also there. You must have a kiraya and rent authority also there. The government will decide what rent you will charge, not the private player himself or themselves dictate what would be the rent. Same way, TRAI decide what kind of fare, what kind of rent you have to take. No any private player can decide, even they create any kind of cartel, they can't decide. Only TRAI will decide, and that regulation of TRAI has made their own government player to run under laws, because they don't have work culture, very fantastic work culture, so that they don't cope up with the private player, and they are trying hard to come in the competition with the private player. They are providing many facilities to their consumer also, keeping a very low charge and providing much better facility. So we are talking about industry. So when we talk about industry, we need more growth rate, we need more employment, we need more investment, we need more income, more demand, so that the cycle of economics can carry on and on. Otherwise, Indian economy, which faced some lower growth rate during the demonetization period, after that COVID period, and after that, before that, because of the application of GST, our economy got some, it was second because of those policy. But now, for last 2 and 3 years, our economy is rising up, and we have become the largest developing economy of the world. We have a highest growth rate. We are touching around 8% growth rate in this 2023-24 financial year. So when we go to the regulation area, we have to identify which are the area where needs the regulation, regulatory authority, in fair interference of government in terms of regulation only, not in terms of day-to-day decision. So same way, if you want to create a level playing field, you may be heard the term level playing field. Just Central Election Commission had told that there must be a level playing field for all political parties. No must have any kind of preferential treatment. The same way, public sector and private sector must have an equal level playing field. If a private insurance company are getting tax benefit like a public sector insurance company, that is required. Because until unless we provide a level playing field, we can't have a very good business atmosphere. And all kind of leverages and all kind of incentive to the investor community or to the all entrepreneurial community, so that we have a more and more enhancement of employment and all. So talking about public and private partnership, I would like to say private player must learn from the public sector company how to generate social welfare, how to create work environment for their employee, and how to do something for the social cause and for some other area. And public sector must learn from the private sector how to create a work culture in their premise, how to become a cost consciousness, how to create their balance between the cost and output. Everything must have an audit. You may be knowing audit is done for the all kind of transaction, all kind of investment and income and expenditure. The same way, there must be audit for the all employee. What is your pay, what is your salary, what is your facility, and what is your output. But that is not being done in the government sector. Once you get employed there, you are fully protected till 60 or till your superannuation period, till your retirement, and nobody is going to touch you, harm you. I think this is not a good policy. And that is why government is not hiring on a permanent basis. They go for the contractual basis, or they just postpone the any recruitment process, and that is why we have a very higher rate of unemployment, educational unemployment. Because central government has around 10 lakh vacant posts, and that has not been filled up. Same way, 60 lakh posts are vacant in state government, and that has not been filled up because of this labor policy and employment policy. They come with the contractual labor hiring, contractual staff hiring, and we have created a two kind of world. One is the permanent staff and another is the contractual staff. I think there must be one policy, one labor policy, one employment policy. If a private player is taking work of three persons with two persons only, because they feel they can save the pay and salary of one employee by employing only two persons in place of three, they are not doing good. They are just increasing their surplus. And same way under government sector, where five people can work all those things, we see there 10 people are there, 15 people are there, and they are spending their whole working time totally ruthless and totally productiveless. So these things can be solved through audit, employment audit, work audit. Same way we do audit of income and expenditure, same way we must do audit of the all human resources. These are the things related with employment and labor area, and here also need of a public-private partnership. We must learn from the, if we are under public sector, we must learn from the private sector how to manage all things. And if we are under private sector, we need to learn how we can generate more and more social welfare and less emphasis on profitability and surplus earning. So when we have a both kind of policy, then we have a balanced sort of policy. We have a very Mediterranean kind of atmosphere in our governance, in our industry, in our environment, in all setups. So that is why the public and private partnership is the need of our. And there are many areas. Recently, example I took of railway. The railway needs a regulatory authority, rent authority, And private sector must be invited there in laying down tracks. We have only 70,000 kilometers of railway tracks. And in last 75 years, we have added only 25,000 kilometers of railway tracks. And during British period and at the time of independence, we have around 50,000 kilometers of railway tracks. So why not we are inviting private players to come and invest in track, laying down track, and just we have revenue sharing, like a build, operate, transfer and lease, BOT and PULT, BOLT. So we can have a sharing, just like the telecom player are doing. So we need a such kind of a public-private partnership and regulatory authority model for so many companies, so many areas, so many industries, and even governance has been also outsourced. Many things are being delegated to the private player or the outsourcing company. And government feel very good because they don't have to bother about hiring, firing, managing and day-to-day micromanagement kind of thing. So we have outsourced and you are free of all kind of worries. And same way, you may be knowing our BPO sector is why it is expanding and it has become a great foreign exchange earner. Because in most of the country, West country, particularly in USA, their labor charge is very high. That is why they outsource their all sorts of software development program to the Indian professional. They find cheaper and they have a more surplus. And we Indian feel that we have got an opportunity to go to America or to do work job for them, even from India. So it has a win-win situation for both, because we in India, we have a huge surplus of population, even technical manpower, we have a very higher numbers. And we are a poor country, our currency is not valued like US dollar. We also feel happy, and many people have got an opportunity to go to America and to work there and earn their bread and butter. So that is, this is a global phenomenon. I am talking about only our domestic field, all kind of policy making thing. So we need, we talked about the policy paralysis. I would like to say there are many areas, even in the municipality. In a municipality, so many things are being done through the government. If we have a private partnership there, if we award contract to a private player, but under set norms, not under any discretionary kind of thing, ki meri marzi hai, maine inko theka de diya, aur mera kuch nahi bigda, aur humne isme commission aur corruption kiye, achhe kaam nahi karaye, achhe unse jo hai humne order nahi liye, product ki quality less rahi, so that is not good. We need a robust kind of regulatory mechanism, regulatory environment. All sorts of our Prime Minister keep talking about minimum government and maximum governance. So this is the area of governance. How you regulate the thing, how we create a regulator and look after everything. And I have come in all sorts of policy mechanisms in my book, because your principal man told me you show your books also to the students, so that they get inspired and try to know about the whole policy environment, under economics and all kind of things. This is a book, A Crusade Against Corruption. This is in two volumes. This book talks about the perennial problem of corruption, malgovernance, and maladministration. And malgovernance and maladministration doesn't mean only the siphoning of public money. So many things are there. This is an encyclopedic book, and it talks about all reason behind reasons. All sorts of political grafting, you may be heard, the electoral bond kind of thing. So since this is a very vast area, so many areas, many professions, doctor, engineers, judges, lawyer, police, technician, mechanics, and there are many areas. We talk about any ministry, departments, we talk about any political party, we talk about any segment of society, we talk about any segment of professions, professionals and sector of economy, they all are crippled with corruption.
So this book has come with all kind of suggestions, all kind of regulation, all kind of environment creation. So I think I have requested your principal ma'am to procure this book for your library. And the thing which I talked about, public-private partnership, it's a great panacea for all kind of economic corruption, corporate corruption. We generally heard about adulteration, underweight and smuggling, kya bolte hai, hawala money, so many smuggling, kya bolte hai, tax evasion, so many economic corruptions are there. So that is why I have advocated about public-private partnership, because it eliminates all sorts of economic corruption which is prevailing in terms of huge surplus and profit earning by the private player, and a total white elephant culture running and operating under public sector. And third books I would like to show, this is a dialogue on system change and initiative to make a new India. This book talks about all kind of area where we need our interference in terms of policy reformulation, institution management, and all sorts of legal and constitutional remedies. So this book talks about all sorts of objective and subjective reform and all kind of fundamental reform which has taken place and what yet to be had to be done. So these things are, I think, is very beneficial for all the students of humanity. It talks about history also, when corruption starts from the Greek and Roman period, and in the middle period, in the pre-Vedic, post-Vedic, in Islamic rule, under British period, and even in the after independence. And all kind of the prevention of corruption, you talk about all kind of CBI, ED, Lokapal, all kind of judiciary judgment, and all sorts of media activism. So we have taken a nationwide survey of five categories of people also, that respondents are public, common public, government servant, public representative, business people, and all sorts of social worker and kind of thing. So my focus was to deal with public-private partnership. It talks about all sorts of checking and repairing of policy paralysis and all sorts of institutional bottleneck which is existing in our economy, in our society, in our polity. And we need a kind of such kind of atmosphere which can invite the role and contribution of everyone in this country, all the role of all citizens of the country. And in that regard, we need several kind of model and several kind of proposition. When I talk about corruption, I talk about seven areas. First, we must have a simple, a very clear-cut, drafted anti-corruption laws. क्योंकि जो laws है हमारे पास वो बड़े complicated है और बड़ा उसमें if and buts लगा हुआ है. करीब 7-8 laws है, बेनामी संपत्ति का, anti-corruption act का, money laundering का, forgive offenders act का. तो इस तरीके के अलग अलग आईपीसी और सीआरपीसी के तहत जो है कई सारे कानून है. तो जितने कानून हो वो बड़ा ही सिंपल हो, सरल हो, और उसकी जो जो वो क्या बोलते हैं क्रिमिनल ज्यूरिसप्रूडेंस सिस्टम में उसका एक पीरियड फिक्स हो कि आपको इतने दिन के अंदर ही जो है उसका फैसला आ जाएगा. जैसे कि गवर्नमेंट में फाइल्स जो है ना महीनों लटकाए रखी जाती है और इसकी वजह से नॉन डिसीजन का एक एटमोस्फेयर बनता है. And it मतलब कि it promotes corruption also. So when we have a very fast movement of files, we have a lesser possibility of corruption. So same way, if decisions are taking in a very fast manner and in a very democratic manner also, it doesn't mean if you want to take a very fast decision, so you just take the decision in a very autocratic manner. It doesn't mean that you have not to take the opinion of other stakeholders. You have to do that, but you have to do all those things in a very fast manner. So first is the very simple law, and second is the a robust kind of institution building. In a way, your, this campus is a very robust kind of institution building. So we need a such type of institution making in all areas, all sector, all places, all department, all institution. And those institutions must be the role model for other institutions. And you have to prove by your work, by your personality, by your deliverance, by your performance, that how will you become a role model for other organizations. We have so many companies, we generally say that the public sector undertaking are white elephants, but the most efficient airline of the world is the Singapore airline, which is a public sector undertaking, which is a public sector player. So it doesn't mean that you are a run under any, whether government or private, you will become a very professional kind of, or very high quality management kind of institution. So first law, second institution, and third is the injection of technology. The technology is the most important thing. If you want a very probity kind of, a very transparent kind of atmosphere in your institution, you just apply technology more and more, you will have a better result than any big kind of SANGTHAN, big kind of any Rishi and Muni. Because technology has nothing to do with any kind of moral thing. It's a technology. It has been programmed in such a manner so ki wahan par na koi corruption ki demand hogi na corruption ki supply hogi. You can see the metro. You may have suffered by metro train. Wahan par koi be-ticket nahi ja sakta aur na hi wahan koi corrupt TT hota hai. Because technology has enabled all these things. So if we inject more and more technology, we have a more and more very robust kind of governance and corruption free, and no tolerance to corruption can be achieved only through injection of more and more technology. But technology, that technology must be foolproof. There must be no any lacuna, loopholes or any kind of complaint. The training which you are getting under this workshop, that is your computer computerization, so computer training and their module must be also foolproof. Because we see that sometimes हमें ऑनलाइन एप्लीकेशन भरना होता है और कई दिन हमारे हमारे खराब हो जाते हैं, दिमाग खराब हो जाता है और वो बड़ा ही मतलब कि यूजर फ्रेंडली नहीं होता. थर्ड टेक्नोलॉजी एंड फोर्थ इज द कॉन्शसनेस, पब्लिक कॉन्शसनेस किस तरीके का है कि वहां पर किसी भी तरीके को आप बर्दाश्त नहीं करते हैं. यू गो टू बॉम्बे, बॉम्बे हैज ए वेरी हार्ड डिसिप्लिन कल्चर. वहां लोग क्यू में लगेंगे, कोई किसी से ऊंची आवाज में बात नहीं करेगा, कोई फालतू का समय नहीं बर्बाद करेगा. वहाँ एक डिसिप्लिन और डिकोरम है. वहाँ की पब्लिक ऐसी है तो वहाँ के गवर्नमेंट ऑफिशियल्स भी करीब करीब उसी कैरेक्टर से बिलोंग करते हैं. तो आपको कहीं ना कहीं एक कॉन्शसनेस भी होना जरूरी है. और छठा है कि एक मोरल रेवोल्यूशन. सब चीज के बावजूद हमें एक मोरल, एक नैतिक क्रांति की भी जरूरत है. अन्यथा सारे चीज अपने प्लेस पर होंगे, ऑफिस भी होगा, कानून भी होगा, नियम भी होगा. हमारी नीयत खराब होगी तो हम तमाम तरह के एक्सक्यूज ला करके, हम तमाम तरीके का अड़ंगा डाल करके हम सिस्टम को खराब करेंगे. तो ये 6-7 तरीके हैं जो कि मेरे, चूंकि मैंने किताब का जिक्र किया और ये किताब हिंदी में भी है जो कि आम लोगों के लिए है. सिंस मैट टोल्ड मी टू जस्ट टॉक अबाउट दिस योर बुक्स आल्सो एंड शो द बुक्स टू देम आल्सो, सो नाउ आई थिंक दैट दिस व्हाट आई हैव टू स्पीक दैट आई हैव मोर ऑर लेस आई हैव ऑलरेडी स्पोकन. इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन, any query, any confusion, I would like to reply them in a very happier mode. So your questions are invited. So anybody has to ask question, you just tell your name and ask your question. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very much, sir, for your kind words and inspiring words. And after the lunch session, I feel that the students, they feel sleepy also, but I observed that they were all listening to sir very carefully. You must have seen journalists on TV and other places, but for the first time you have heard a journalist speaking in front of you. He is not only the journalist, but he is the editor of the books also. He is the publisher for his own books also. And he is just, the sir is donating these books, or he is giving the books to the principal ma'am also, as sir has just spoken when ma'am had just gone outside. So we will keep in the library also. So whenever you feel like, you can read these books also. And I would like to appreciate sir's words because, you know, he has touched almost all the topics of private and public policies here also. Because basically he is from the economy. You can also say that he is an economist and he has spoken about so many things. And you must have heard about white elephant, public consciousness, and why is corruption increasing in the society? What are the things, what are the factors that are promoting corruption? So he has almost touched all the topics and you are mature enough to understand each and everything, right? So you should clap for yourselves also because... because you were listening very carefully after the lunch session also. And from my side and on behalf of Principal Ma'am, please give sir a huge round of applause. Now this is, as it is the tradition that we just invite our guests, so they are just like deity for us. So this is the part of Indian culture. So we are going to present a memento to sir as a part of memory, as a token of appreciation and memory. We want to carry in our heart. So I think as per your instructions, this workshop will continue till 5 minutes.